Now we're going to take a look at shock in the pediatric patient. Now I've oftentimes described it this way, that if a person dies, they almost always die from some form of shock, regardless of what the cause of the shock. Remember, the definition of shock is the inadequate tissue perfusion. This means that the body is unable to circulate blood with adequate oxygenation to the vital organs and the rest of the body due to different things like loss of blood, maybe sepsis, impaired heart function, anaphylaxis. Now, though there are many different subcategories and causes of one form of shock or another, the main types we will be addressing are hypovolemic, distributive, cardiogenic, and obstructive. Let's look at hypovolemic. Hypovolemic shock is characterized by low cardiac output caused from incidences like severe bleeding. Now, initially, systolic blood pressure may appear normal, but there will be a narrow pulse pressure. Peripheral pulses will be weak or absent, and the patient's level of consciousness decreases as shock progresses. The body will continue to shunt blood flow to the extremities in order to increase blood flow to the vital organs until those late stages of hypovolemic shock. Now, with distributive shock, such as sepsis or neurogenic, systemic vascular resistance is reduced, which leads to excessive vascular space. In other words, the container has gotten bigger. Blood flow is severely reduced to vital organs, resulting in poor distribution of oxygen. And unlike hypovolemic shock, peripheral perfusion may appear to be adequate. Blood flow to the extremities may be actually increased because of the reduced vascular resistance. The extremities actually might be warm due to the widened vessels and the greater blood flow to the skin. It can be a little bit confusing at times. Now, cardiogenic shock is a failure of the heart to pump correctly, and it's distinguished from other types by marked increased respiratory effort. The key for treatment is to increase cardiac output. Usually, we do this with medication, which improves the myocardial function. But unlike hypovolemic or distributive shock, fluid replacement needs to be done slowly over time. Rapid fluid replacement will reduce cardiac output and oxygenation and can increase the risk for pulmonary edema. Obstructive shock is when a mechanical or physical obstruction limits the blood flow. An example of this would be like cardiac tamponade or a tension pneumothorax or even a pulmonary embolism. These are all examples of what could cause this form of shock. Signs and symptoms are very similar to hypovolemic shock. However, the underlying cause helps us to determine the type of shock that it is and its possible treatment even in the field. For example, a blunt force trauma to the chest would indicate that there's a high risk for a tension pneumo or a cardiac tamponade situation. In contrast, external bleeding would be more indicative of hypovolemic shock. Immediate recognition and correcting the underlying cause of obstructive shock is most important when it comes to survival. With infants and children, all types of shock can quickly lead to the ultimate failure of the body, which is cardiac arrest, and especially if it's not treated early. The progression to cardiac arrest especially is fast in these sweet little children that have gone from a state of compensated shock, where their heart is racing, their respiratory rate is high, they seem to be trying to compensate well, but then suddenly they exhaust. And then they go into what we call late stage decompensating shock. That is a tough syndrome to get them out of. So early recognition of shock and immediate treatment is most critical to saving this child's life. The first treatment for shock is maintaining an open airway and delivering high flow supplemental oxygen. After the airway is open and the oxygen is in place, the next priority is vascular access. If a child is in hypotensive shock, vascular access for fluid replacement is critical. Now, typically, placing an IO is most effective and more efficient than attempting an IV, especially when a child is in vascular compromise or even vascular collapse. When the IV or IO is in place, a bolus of an isotonic crystalloid such as normal saline should be given at 20 mL per kilogram over 5 to 10 minutes. A bolus of 20 mL per kilogram may be repeated if necessary. If signs of pulmonary edema occur or signs of shock worsen, stop the bolus. Now, because hypoglycemia is common in critically ill children and infants, blood glucose levels need to be checked early on in the treatment plan. If low glucose levels are not identified early and treated, brain injury can occur. Hyperglycemia could also be present and contribute to the shock symptoms. Remember, we're wanting to look for the H's and T's to help identify and treat underlying causes of shock. If a child or infant remains hypotensive after the bolus of fluid is administered, we may consider epinephrine with IV or IO access. We're going to give this at 0.1 to 1 microgram per kilogram per minute. Dopamine, IV or IO, can also be given. That will be delivered 10 to 20 micrograms per kilogram per minute. Or norepinephrine, delivered IV or IO, at 0.1 to 2 micrograms per kilogram per minute. Remember, when caring for shock, and especially after medication administration, frequent reassessment of the child's respiratory, cardiovascular, and neurological status to determine their needs for further treatment are so vital. Serial and frequent vitals are extremely important until after the child has been stabilized and turned over to the next level of care.